Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. Nice to have you with us today. We're here to talk about the issues that can empower us so we make more intelligent and reasonable choices. You'll hear that today. We have several commentaries. We're going to do a commentary from Stella Morento about how to escape the age of mass delusion. Chris Hedges from Tutig, our ever deadlier police state, comments on the environment, including the sea beneath us. Sea level rise has a gotcha from behind twin, rising groundwater. It's already here. I've talked about it. We'll go into great depth on that. And then a guest in the second part of our program, Rita Palma. And Rita is a citizen activist. She is a parent advocate for vaccine exemptions and the founder of My Kids, My Choice, which assists parents to navigate New York State immunization exemption laws and to oppose vaccine mandates. So she'll be here because New York State is becoming another state like California that is not going to allow you an opportunity to opt out. Also, we're going to have a intake on the National Security Agency whistleblower. The government is collecting everything you do. Also, more information on a call to action on 5G rollout in Washington, D.C., and Dr. Suzanne Humphreys on vaccine ingredients. They're neither safe for any single or collective vaccine. This is one of two parts. So you see, we have a lot of ground to cover. We begin with diet and health. This is from the Ludwig Maximilian University, which is in Munich, and it talks about how diet influences our genes. Now, you know that what we eat can directly affect the genetic programs that regulate cellular function. Well, this is a brand new European Union project coordinated by LMU researchers to explore how the product of metabolism intervenes in gene regulation. Now, the incidence of chronic illness, like obesity, you see it every day, and diabetes, even high blood pressure, they're already passing the high levels. That should alarm everyone. But from just common sense, if the way that we have been taught to live more recently, let's say in the last 30 years, has actually made us sicker as a whole, shouldn't we be challenging the rightness of those social norms? Of course we should, and many of you do. That's why you're listening to this program. And when we're dealing with metabolic syndrome, that's ultimately attributable to the biochemical metabolism, and all are caused by a combination of lifestyles. For example, a polluted and denatured diet, the average American diet. Genetic influences, how much we exercise, how sedentary are we. However, genes do not rigidly determine how an organism processes its food. On the contrary, recent evidence indicates that intermediates produced during the biochemical reactions involved in the breakdown of nutrients can themselves have an impact on gene regulation. Indeed, cells can actually be reprogrammed by such substances. Just remember, much of what you're eating every day is directly converted into metabolic products that play a part in controlling how our genes function. And so that's important. So just, there's what was called the genomic project. And it showed that the genomic DNA carried by each cell encodes the information necessary for the synthesis of the different proteins produced by a given tissue organ. Now, we've been led to believe that whatever you were born with, whatever your DNA is, it's inalterable. It's there for life. Not true. Absolutely not true. For example, we know that long DNA molecules with a set of proteins called histones, and which genes are activated or repressed in a given cell, is a part determined by so-called epigenetic modifications of the chromatin. And these are comparatively simple chemical tags that service molecular switches. So is the switch turned on? Good, healthy, immune response. Well, then you have to have good food to turn on the good genes. Bad foods, processed foods, hot doggers, hamburgers, French fries, potato chips, pizzas, artificial sweeteners, caffeine and alcohol, bad the gene, and they turn off the same switch that a good lifestyle turns on. Good gut microflora, meaning good bacteria in your gut, turns on the healing in the body. Bad bacteria produced by sugar and yeasty foods turns off that and creates a very toxic milieu. So let me put this real simple. I was only about 22 years of age, and I was invited to a retreat upstate. It was the first time I'd gone to a retreat upstate. What impressed me when I got out of the car was that it looked just old and run down. It looked like something out of the hills of West Virginia, where I'd come from. It was a big old white house that evidently years before had been in the 1930s, 40s, and 50s, had been a spa of some type, a health rejuvenation spa. In any case, I'm going to say the average person's age was 70. There were some people in their 90s. And I, of course, was the youngest person. And the reason I was invited was because my publisher, Mrs. Speller, she was a natural hygienist. And she very much believed in Bernard McFadden and the old natural hygiene school. You know, eat vital foods, believe in vitalism, align your life with vital causes. And she was right. I was young, naive, and probably only had half a brain functioning. So I was new to this, and I was intrigued, having no firsthand in-depth experience. What I watched were all day for 2.5 days were lectures and discussions, just informal, sitting around, talking about the gut. Everything was the gut. You know, that the life and death begin in the gut. I remember him saying that over and over again. And they had fermented things that I didn't like at all. They say, "What do you think of this, Gary? This is really good." And I'd sniff it and go, "Whoa. You know, my brother's feet smell better than that. His feet stunk so bad that we had to put him out of the car when we went to drive-in movies." Of course, everyone else in surrounding cars immediately rolled up their windows. So this stuff's really stunk, and it tasted worse than it smelled. But I wanted to be polite, so I just smiled and took a little bit of bite of this and a little drink of that. But they were all ferments, and everything was different types of ferments. And today, my goodness, we're realizing they were so far ahead of the curve. These were probiotics. These were colonizing, seeding with good bacteria our guts, and therefore the health of the gut, the health of the brain, the health of the immune system, the health of our biochemistry, health of our metabolism, all interconnected. And so I came away from there feeling sad that these people would live such remarkable lives of purity in that sense and with their diet. And I just looked at this massive fast food movement that was gaining momentum and how few people would have the intelligence or discipline to follow the principles that they had laid down. But they were naturalists. They all had read Thoreau and Whitman and all the others and Audubon. And they spent time, they could determine all the different wild plants, and they were picking and harvesting and having in salads different greens. So it was, for me, it was a remarkable influence. And much of their teachings never left me. But now we know that our genes are not inaudible. We can do a lot of good things to bad genes. So that's the message. Take away. Now, if you've seen the Chinese people today, they're very stressed. They no longer live under a system where everything is socialized. That's why the average China person has 47% savings, because if they get sick, They know the state will not pay for it, so this is why they save so much. India's right up behind them. But you also see things you haven't seen in Chinese history. Massive obesity, especially in children. A new study from Shandong University Institute of Preventive Medicine, published in the European Journal of Preventive Cardiology, shows that China is paying the price for adopting our Western lifestyle with soaring childhood obesity. Now, this was a 29-year study involving 28,000 children and adolescents, and only even less than 1% were obese when it started in 1985. Today, it's 17%. Now, you're talking about China having more children than we in the United States have entire people. They're getting fatter. And with that, heart disease, arthritis, cancer, and diabetes, adult diabetes. So the takeaway message is don't ever follow the American diet. And other people are doing that. Follow a natural diet and live longer and stay healthier and have healthier children. From the University of Connecticut comes a study about the active ingredients in both hot peppers and cannabis. They both calm the gut's immune system. Now, you wouldn't think that chili peppers and marijuana have much in common, but when eaten, both interact with the same receptor in our stomachs. That's according to a paper published by the Proceedings of the National Academy of Science, the number one scientific body in America, if not the world. So what will probably happen from this is there'll be new research where new therapies to treat diabetes and colitis and all of the other itises open up, especially your immune system and the gut and the brain. Now, of course, they're going to be looking for a drug to do this. They'll take the active ingredient in marijuana and the active ingredient in cayenne instead of simply having the two together. You don't need a doctor to do that. So, for example, when you have a chili pepper, you feel the heat in your mouth. And biochemically, you aren't wrong. The capsaicin chemical in the pepper binds to a receptor that triggers a nerve that fires off to your brain. Hot. Those same receptors are found throughout the gastrointestinal tract for reasons that have still not known. So that also helps you with type diabetes, for example. So just something to think about. I always try to get you science that's ahead of the curve. Also, chronic fatigue syndrome is linked to an imbalance in the microbiome. This is from Columbia University's Mellman School of Public Health, published in the peer-reviewed journal Microbiome. So what it says is simple. It says that they've discovered abnormal levels of specific gut bacteria related to chronic fatigue syndrome and other forms of encephalomyelitis in patients with or without recurrent irritable bowel syndrome. And the study's among the first to disentangle imbalances in the gut bacteria. So it means in lay language that you could be having muscle pain, joint pain, cognitive dysfunction, sleep disturbances, and osteostatic intolerance simply because you have an imbalance in the microbiome, the bacteria. Now, if you have that, in all probability, you're either drinking or eating something that's creating that imbalance. So for those who said you can detoxify and cleanse, they were right. And so by having healthier intestinal bacteria, your whole body system improves. And also, orange essential oil can help alleviate post-traumatic stress disorder. This is from George Washington University. We know that a lot of Americans, not just ex-vets or current vets, but upwards of 8% of the American population will develop post-traumatic stress disorder at some point in their lives. And yet treatments for this debilitating condition are almost always limited to drugs. And it's my contention, based upon reviewing the scientific literature on those antipsychotic medications, that that indeed leads to suicidal ideation, with about 20 to 22 vets every single 24 hours killing themselves. Generally, they'll put a gun in their mouth and blow their brains out. And no one asks at the Pentagon or in the Defense Department or the White House or any place else in government, why are they doing this? Could it be that we're putting them in harm's way, physically, psychologically? Could it be that when we take them through training, basic training, boot camp, we take away their empathy, we get them to be servile to disciplinary rules, so whatever they're told to do, they will do it without questioning? And that is what can lead to them seeing or doing things that they would never think to do if they weren't conditioned to be robotically obedient to authority. And then they come home, and there's no boot camp or decommissioning process to rehabilitate their brains, their personalities, their sense of judgment. As a result, when they go into a family life that they had before, they're not the same person. It's much like the Manchurian Candidate or the Invasion of the Body Snatchers. It looks like the person, it sounds like the person, but there's something not there. Yeah. Their brain has been altered, and as a result, their emotions are altered. So we should be looking for non-pharmaceutical options to help these souls to reacclimate. And one of the ways, just one, it's one piece of the puzzle, is orange essential oil. After a stressful situation, when this was used, it showed improvements in markers of stress and fear. So it's one way to help people with post-traumatic stress disorder. Another way to do it is just to carry a can around with you. They're inexpensive. And it either has lemon or orange. Well, okay, there's lavender also. Take the orange. You're in a stressful situation in the office? Okay. Just get three spritzes above your head. It'll go up into the air, and as it cascades slowly down, the pheromone reaction will be immediate, and you'll be calmed. You can also take that same essential oil and put about three drops on your pillow at night. That and lavender, put lavender on one side of your pillow and orange essence essential oil on the other side, you're going to have a much more relaxing sleep, and a whole behavioral response will be better. Oh, and by the way, it's very antiseptic too. Well, there is a lot of truth to the idea that the longer we exercise, the more we exercise, the longer we live. All the studies show that. But then McMaster's University in Canada found something else. Just 1 minute of intense, very intense exercise produces health benefits. Not at the same level as if you're exercising regularly, but still it helps better than doing nothing. Just 60 seconds of very intense exercise produces health benefits that are important for you. All right? So whatever you're going to do, do it with intensity. Push-ups, sit-ups, intensity. Curls, intensity. Walking fast, very fast. That's the intensity. And it worked. They did a study on this. And also, yoga can have health benefits for people with asthma from the Cochrane Collaboration. That's a scientific group. And it suggests that yoga can have a beneficial effect on symptoms and quality of life in people with asthma. And that's important. One more reason that yoga was good. And they studied 15 randomized controlled trials over 1,048 men and women, and found that it really does make a difference, especially with people with asthma. Also, curcumin could combat colitis. Baylor University. A formula that blends curcumin and turmeric oils can improve a person's anti-inflammatory burden if you have colitis. Well, this was published in Nature Scientific Reports. So turmeric is most potent when it's in its oil form, and it reduces colitis symptoms, so why wouldn't it also reduce diverticulitis, colitis, spastic colon, Crohn's disease? They're all different inflammatory processes. And I found from my own clinical experience working with people it does. Also, chronic inflammation leads to imbalanced blood system and potential cancer risk. It's the University of Colorado Cancer Center, published in Nature Cell Biology. And the study shows that chronic exposure to an inflammatory emergency signal, what is called interleukin-1, causes blood-forming bone marrow stem cells to produce cells needed to fight infection and repair injury, but at the expense of their own ability to self-renew and maintain healthy blood system. And that results in overproduction of aggressive immune cells capable of severely damaging tissues. That's the interleukin elevated one. And that's what you get almost always with chronic inflammation. So that's one of the things we should know, that curcumin can help with that. And anything that's positive can help, we're going to support. Finally, vitamin D insufficiency or deficiency. You have a low rate of DNA methylation, especially in African-American teens, and that increases your risk of disease. This is Medical College of Georgia. So what does it mean in just lay language? It means that if a black teenager is low in vitamin D, it correlates with low activity of a major mechanism for controlling gene expression that may increase the risk of cancer and other diseases. Now, it's not difficult to get vitamin D. I would suggest that you get vitamin D by simply taking a supplement. 2,000, 3,000 units a day. And this was published in the peer-reviewed journal PLOS ONE. That's the latest on health and healing. I'm Gary Null. Back in a moment, we'll take some of your calls at that time. And by the way, for those of you just tuning on, and we want to thank the thousands of new people. We've had an influx of people, and I'm not sure why that's happening, but it's just terrific. For whatever reason, I'm not aware, but thank you for coming on board. But we have three numbers to give you, so please write this down. And if others in the audience have forgot it, if you'd like to call in anytime, 24/7, and leave a message, any message you want, that as long as it's positive, this is not a line for ranting or, you know, raking on something. But if you have legitimate questions on issues that you would like to have an answer to, I'm happy to address those. Here's our voice mail line number, 862-800-6805. Again, 862-800-6805. But let's say that you're traveling and you're out. You're not at home listening on WBAI or one of the other stations all over America that broadcasts this. I want to thank our good friends up in Woodstock for broadcasting this every day also. Here's the number to listen live no matter where you're at in North America or Canada. 641-793-7091, 641-793-7091. But let's say that the only time you're away, you're traveling, your work, you're going to listen later. Okay, here's the number you call, 701-719-9976, 701-719-9976. We're going to take a brief break and come right back to whatever questions you have. I'm sitting here, happy to address them.
What is the difference between a cell and a stem cell?
That's it. That's the shortest question I've ever had asked, and not difficult to answer. First, understand your cells are what you have that have matured. And then behind those maturing cells are more cells, and you might have seven deep in a particular area of cells. And as you are wearing and tearing those cells, for example, if you're outside and you're around too much sunlight and ultraviolet light, the cells, the epithelial cells, which are at your dermis cells, are going to get burned, and they'll start to slough off. And then another group of cells come forward as the old cells are diminished. And also when we scrub our body every day and do our shampoo and shower, we're exfoliating. We're opening up our pores, which is why when you shampoo, you should massage your head, not just rub some shampoo on it and rinse it off. That doesn't do a whole lot. You've got to really get in there with your fingers, all your eight fingers and two thumbs, and massage, massage, massage. And then rinse, and that means you're opening up the pores, the sebum, is coming out. The sebaceous glands are also releasing their bacteria and toxins and salts and minerals, and also pollutants, heavy metals, come out also through our sweat. So this is a constant process of mitosis. The same is true in your gut. Your gut turns over about 1% of its cells every day, and sometimes more. And that's why when we're eating, if we eat more alkaline foods, beans and fruits, and grains, nuts and seeds, that's much healthier for the cells and their turnover and their health, so they don't get diseased, as when you eat meat or something caustic or alcohol, which is very destructive and corrosive. Coffee is very corrosive also and very anabolic. So those are your cells, and we know we can do a lot to rejuvenate those cells. But then you have the whole phenomena of stem cells. Now, I'll do all this shortly in lay language, but you have some embryonic stem cells. And needless to say, as embryonic in tone, they come from human embryos. Generally, they're very, very new, 3 to 5 days old. And they're generally taken when or harvested during in vitro fertilization. That means that they're going to fertilize an embryo in a laboratory instead of inside a female body. And embryonic stem cells are also known as pluripotent stem cells. These cells can then become other types of cells in the body. Therefore, they're greatly differentiated. Then you have what are known as non-embryotic or adult stem cells. And they're found in infants and children also, but the stem cells come from developed organs and tissues, and they're used by the body to repair and replace damaged tissue. And then we have adult stem cells. They can't differentiate into as many other types of cells as embryonic stem cells. And then you have what is called induced pluripotent stem cells. And scientists now know how to turn adult stem cells into pluripotent stem cells. And these new type of cells are called induced pluripotent stem cells, and they can differentiate into anything. So if you needed brain cells, lung cells, eye cells, that's entirely possible. And then you have what is called cord blood stem cells or amniotic fluid stem cells. Needless to say, that it comes from the umbilical cord after childbirth. They can be frozen and then used in their research. A lot of research now into treating children with leukemia and certain genetic blood disorders. So that at least lets you know that that's what a stem cell is. Now, the big deal is, and I'm speaking with people around the world all the time in my anti-aging research, remember it actually was closer to 35 years, I was in the Institute of Applied Biology almost every day. I was, in 1996, I believe it was, in the fall, I was given an honor of becoming the second only research fellow at the Institute, and after over a quarter century of work there. And my work was in anti-aging medicine. And I did all types of research. I didn't care what type of research it was as long as it was something that could be able to help people who were suffering some of the age-related diseases, not because aging itself creates diseases, because how we age, I want to make that clear, how we age, what we eat as we age, what we do in exercise or other choices, including stress, directly impacts our aging process. It'll speed it up or slow it down. It'll be healthy aging because we're living healthy, or it'll be unhealthy aging, in which case diabetes and arthritis and high blood pressure, multiple sclerosis are coming from that. So now, and I was doing with nutrients what now they're doing with stem cell-based therapies. So today we can realistically and accurately say that the issues to be treated with embryonic stem cells would be traumatic spinal cord injuries and stroke. There you're talking about millions of people. Severe burns and rheumatoid arthritis and heart disease and hearing loss and retinal disease, Huntington's disease and Parkinson's disease. And now we are told not to go to Europe, because the stem cell research they're doing over there isn't under the qualified eyes of our FDA. And that may be partially true. What I would say in its place is, I've heard, in fact, I just counseled a physician, board certified, practicing 45 years, who goes to Europe, and he was surprised that I knew anything about the natural stem cell live therapy, what are called live cell therapies there. And I talked about the Nehan's clinic, and that's where he had gotten his therapy. And what it is the Nehan's clinic was where they would take sheep and they would keep them in pure grass pastures. They would then remove certain cells, and then they would purify the cell and then implant it into a person. So if you had a bad heart, or bad lung, or your brain, the stem cells were shown to go migrate in higher quantities to the diseased organ. Now, when I contacted the FDA before one of my trips to Germany, they said there is no such research in the world. There's no scientific literature. Fine. So I went to the University of Heidelberg, and I found 500 different studies in their peer-reviewed literature. They were correct. There was no studies done in the United States, but there were an awful lot of good studies done in Europe. And it showed the differentiation factor. So then I went to the clinic, and I went to Dr. Klaus Martin's clinic. Later I would go to Dr. Elliot Goldwag and Dr. Ivan Popoff. Very bright people, very well credentialed, and they had different clinics. And I first looked at their methodology, then I looked at their treatments, and then I interviewed the people. Now, mind you, this wasn't a little tiny 24-gauge needle. These were large needles. Just imagine someone sticking a giant nail, a spike nail, into your butt, and sometimes four or five of them. Now, of course, they would numb them first, but these were big needles. I remember looking and thinking, oh my God, I wouldn't want one of those stuck in me, because it really wasn't an injection, it was an implant. In any case, I interviewed 55 people at the Klaus Martin Clinic over a two-week period. Every day, all day, I was talking with people. And they all claimed they kept coming back about every 5 years because the stem cells worked for about 5 years. And then they had to get it renewed. Every single person said the same thing, and that they found amazing benefits. But here's what every one of those 55 people said, and I confirmed this with Dr. Martin. In fact, I have some photographs of this, I believe, up on somewhere. I have them all on my website. So I asked the people, when you go home, do you eat a diet like you're served here, a healthy diet? No. Do you exercise? No. Do you stop smoking? No. Drinking? No. Nothing in their lifestyle changed. And I thought, well, what would happen if you changed your lifestyle and you then got the stem cells? They didn't know. They didn't care. They didn't want to change their lifestyle. And that was true across the board at all these clinics. Anyhow, this gentleman physician was getting his, and he was unaware that I knew all this about stem cells or live cells injections. And he said American doctors are just, they're not informed of this. Okay. Well, I hope that answers your question. We'll take one more call.
Hi, this is a question for Gary. I have a question. You see some pills, herb pills, and they're a product of China. I don't know, is China heavily sprayed with their, I don't know anything, and with their products? Even though it's a product of China, it's imported from Brooklyn, but I don't know, I guess it's made in China, I'm not sure. But if it is made in China, but the product, are they heavily sprayed?
There's no general statement about that. It has to be very specific. China can make some, in fact does, some of the state-of-the-art technological products in the world, and it's made to very high standards. In fact, if you look at where your cell phones come from, where most of our computers come from, and televisions, and appliances, used to be the United States, it's China. So in that regard, they have very specific challenges that they cannot create something that is bad or sloppy or dangerous because it'll be recalled and they'll lose those gigantic contracts, which put millions of people to work in China. At the other end of that, they're boiling dogs and cats alive every day by the thousands. So you wonder, how do you go from one extreme, beautiful cities, Shanghai and Hong Kong, which is Chinese, was British, but not now, and you look at the architecture, you look at the design of how this was implemented, some massive solar programs, one of the largest water solar programs in the world, putting floating solar systems on water, and they're the tops in the world. So they're both the top and the bottom in the world. When you have almost a million Uyghurs and people of Muslim faith that you're putting in effect concentration camps, you're harvesting their organs while they're still alive. And this was, if I found this out and reported on it, which I did over 20 years ago on WBAI, then easily the New York Times and 60 Minutes could have done a special showing there were hospitals all over China that had hundreds of thousands of patients, all from this one meditative group. It's just a meditative group. It's not even a religion. But the Chinese Communist Party, that's another oxymoron. Communist, no, it's not communist. It's more capitalist than communist. It uses capitalism for its own enrichment, and it uses communism as a way of maintaining control over its citizens. In either case, it's completely authoritarian and utterly corrupt. So, they would take out eyes and sell them all over the world and organs. That's why someplace you have to wait 3 years to get a liver. In China, if you go in and one liver doesn't fit you, well, in 10 minutes they've got another liver, and 10 minutes after that, another liver. Big money made when you're harvesting that amount. Mind you, these are the dichotomies and discrepancies in just one country. But when it comes to food, that is one thing that I'd be extremely careful of. Herbs, foods of any type, I would say no. Now, we are always given two pictures, the truth and then the illusion of the truth. The truth, almost all of the aloe vera in the United States for decades came from the Dominican Republic. The illusion, oh my goodness, there's this company out in Nevada, another one in Arizona, another one in South Dakota, and they're making these great aloe vera products. No, they're giving the illusion they're great products. How do I know? Hearsay, rumor, conjecture? No. My brothers and I went down to the Dominican Republic. We went way up into the mountains, and when you get up into the mountains in the Dominican Republic near the Haitian border, because Hispaniola is one island, it's divided two-thirds, not quite two-thirds to the Dominican Republic, and little over a third to Haiti, and it looks like a moonscape, and there's where they have their aloe farms, and these are huge, and They spray toxic chemicals. I watch toxic chemicals. I watch kids spraying. Remember, I'm watching him spraying an elevator plant. There was some kind of insect flying around the plant. So he was just like playing, oh, I'm going to squirt it here and squirt it there. He squirted like a quart of DDT on one plant just trying to kill this one insect. In any case, they took all the aloe vera into an old airplane hangar, had a dirt floor. And there they had these counters lined up, about 10 of them. They looked like a checkout counter of a store. And they had big 55-gallon barrels, and they were souffling the aloe vera. I mean, no sanitation at all. You know, young, old, immature, overly mature. They'd fillet them and scent the gel, just pick it up and throw it in this jug, and then they would pour, no measurement, just pour some kind of chemical preservative. That's what got shipped to those other places, and that's what got bottled. So the public wasn't getting a quality product. I was there, guys walking around with shotguns. The only reason they allowed me on the property is because I let them believe I was going to be a potential buyer, wanted to see some of their operation. So you see, we have to distinguish the how something is sold to us versus the reality of it. And that's why foods from China, no. Herbs from China, no. Okay? Let's see. We're going to take one more call, and then we'll go to a commentary.
Hi, I'm Luann. I've been a nurse for over 42 years. In adult medicine, oncology, neurology, geriatrics, and hematology. And I'm bringing this topic up because I think it's very, very, very important for people to know. I've been working in integrative medicine now for the past 25 years. And I was working with someone who was following Gary Null's protocols. And her daughter wrote a wonderful report on the dangers of vaccines. And her mother was so proud that her daughter put this whole report together. And when she got her test paper back, she got an F. They failed her. And when the mother asked why, they said, well, we looked Gary Null up on Wikipedia, and it said that he's a charlatan and a quack. So we can't use any of this work. Well, the good news was that they did go back and they took all of the research that Gary had done over the last 40 to 50 years on the dangers of vaccines, and they resubmitted it. But what concerned me was the fact that this was being written about Gary Null on Wikipedia. They're wrong about him, and I'll tell you why. When I first started working with Gary, I was a skeptic. I worked for 18 years as a nurse administrator, right orthodox medicine. I worked and lived in the belly of the beast. I was completely conventional medicine. And when people got sick, we were using a pharmaceutical model. They were very, very limited, the medical doctors, on how they treat medical conditions. Everything was about a synthetic drug with a litany of side effects. So when I started studying integrative medicine, the reason I did was because I was diagnosed with cancer myself. And I became very curious about what other options, because in conventional medicine, again, the doctors are indoctrinated to use the model, the pharmaceutical model they've been taught to use in school, as I was as a nurse. So basically, when people get sick, especially with cancer, you're going to get chemotherapy, radiation, surgery, and then if the chemotherapy doesn't work, we move on and we give you more chemotherapy, some of it experimental, and then when that doesn't work, we put you into hospice. All of these are cost centers for the hospital. And I worked for a very successful New York City medical center, very profitable medical center. And what I realized was that I became very disenfranchised because no one got well. No one got well. All we did was keep them on the treadmill of pharmaceutical drugs. And when I started studying with, integrative medicine, and I went to Gary's Tri-State Healing Center in New York City. This was in the 90s. And what I noticed there was something that I had never seen in my career. I saw people reversing chronic illnesses. And then I realized that Gary Null represents another paradigm with regards to approaching health and disease. For the past 50 years, this man has written books. He's done broadcasts on long-standing radio programs. He's done testimonials to legislators. He's an activist. He's made films, award-winning films and documentaries. He's entered into debates. He's been doing it like this all along. And nobody is recognizing the fact that just because he's coming from a different paradigm and getting results, they're kind of shying away because they don't recognize what he's doing. It's not coming from their paradigm. So when I was sick, I started going to the Tri-State Healing Center in New York City. And I was with people that had end-stage diseases. And I watched over time how they reversed these diseases. Gary would create protocols for each person, and he would sit with them for hours. Now, I worked in the hospital still, and I would come there every single evening. And I watched very carefully. I mean, when you stepped into the center, there was a lightness of being there. He had a stress management room. He had a hypnotherapist that would help people to ground their energy. He had a holistic dentist, a chiropractor. He had an acupuncturist. He had a massage therapist. He had a colonic therapist. He had board-certified medical doctors, and these were not physicians that dressed in your traditional shirt and tie and white jacket. There was a very casual atmosphere so that the doctors didn't feel like, they didn't appear like they were an authority figure, a holier than thou. They were all part of a team. There were nurses there in the IV room, and he had a nutritionist. In the IV room, there was an aquarium. It was beautiful. And I watched as not only I started reversing my chronic conditions, but I watched the people who came specifically in the evening, and these were the patients that had AIDS. And I'm talking about people with Kaposi sarcoma, pneumocystis, carini, thrush, fungus, wasting diseases. And I watched them improve, which was very unfamiliar territory for me as a nurse in oncology and adult medicine for 18 years. It was very unfamiliar to me. So one of the things that really impressed me was the fact that I watched eight people who seroconverted from HIV positive to HIV negative. There were no more infections. Their T cell count improved significantly. And I kept seeing people seroconverting not only AIDS, but viruses as well. And I'm someone who also began seroconverting my own viruses. Now, I came with cancer, hepatitis B. I had my precancerous breast tumors were becoming cancerous. I had polycystic ovaries. I had a number of chronic conditions. I had acne. I had very severe thrush and yeast infections because I had antibiotics that I was taking for my adult acne. So I was deconstructing all that, again, with Gary, right there, with everybody. And it was not just people with AIDS, which, first of all, it's unheard of in the AIDS community in a regular hospital to watch people seroconvert from HIV positive to HIV negative. What was more disconcerting to me as a nurse was the fact that even though Gary had a press conference to share, oh, my goodness, he had hundreds of people with their records, with their medical records right there to be shown at the press conference. He invited all members of the press. And the only people that showed up were key members of the African American community who took a great interest in what he was doing. People like Stogie Carmichael and Isaac Hayes, these were people that were absolutely impressed and very present for what Gary was doing. So that also really, it bothered me quite a bit, because here I'm thinking, because one of the things I asked Gary is, why doesn't everybody know about this? Look at what you're doing. You're doing this amazing work. And he said, because they can't relate to it. It's not something that they're going to plug into their paradigm. It's not something that they're going to be able to control in terms of generating revenue. And that was a real brick in the back of the head for me, if you will. So, you know, Gary is doing what no one else is doing. And at that point, I realized that, and he said this to me, that whole meeting, the press conference, was an intentional boycott. Because he's doing what no one else is doing. And I realized no other voices are allowed into the current paradigm. And boy, if that isn't truer today than ever, especially in the area of forced vaccines. And it was this that convinced me to leave the job that I was in. I gave up the lies because I never saw people get well. On one level, by playing their game, I had to believe in my mind that I was helping people. But how could I say I'm helping people when the results were, you know, intoxication and death? And another whole cost center is getting people into nursing homes, skilled nursing facilities. It was a game that I couldn't play anymore. So I stepped out of that entire paradigm, and I went on to get credentialed in integrative and alternative medicine. I got my degree. I have an advanced degree in natural health. I have a 4-year degree in Chinese medicine. I went on to get credentialed as a health and wellness coach. And I've never looked back.
I never know how long these are going to last. I'd like to hear what else she has to say, but what's important in what she said was that it was only by coming to the center back in the 1980s and 90s for herself, because she had 3 life-ending diseases that no amount of medicine would help, and then she reversed her own diseases completely, that she saw other people reversing their diseases, including she saw 8 people, because she was actually there every night, and people would ask her, would you read my blood chemistries? And she'd get their blood chemistries from the week before, and she'd show them how they're doing, and she saw all 8 seroconvert. Not only all diseases gone, total health restored, but they went from HIV positive to negative. No one's ever done that before, ever, anywhere. And that was just in that one group, plus that the Institute of Applied Biology, you heard Elena say, leading scientist there for 50 years. She brought me 10 of hers, all 10 seroconverted. That's 18 that's on the record. Let's now go over, because I want to get our panelist in here, just not a panelist, but our guest, Rita Palma from Long Island. She is the parent advocate for vaccine exemptions. Nice to have you with us today, Rita.
Thank you, Gary. Nice to be on.
Rita, we're concerned on the larger picture because behind the scenes are legions of lobbyists representing Big Pharma, and they're working with ALEC, the American Legislative Exchange Council, some 200 to 300 at any given time, major corporations that write bills in secret, give them to our highly compromised state legislators, many of them, and then they take them and make them as laws in their state without telling us who was behind them. And right now they're doing that in New York State with Senate Bill 2994, S2994, and Assembly Bill A2371, 2371. Yep. And that will ban religious exemptions from vaccines. Now, the trouble is none of these people have spent 15,000 hours of research, scholarly research, reviewing all the clinical and experimental data on vaccine safety and efficacy. I have, and at least seven physicians have. None of these people are aware of the truth about vaccines.
They haven't spent 15 seconds on. They haven't.
So tell us what. Tell us your story on this.
The bill to repeal the religious exemption does exactly that. Parents have a carve-out right now, two carve-outs, medical exemption, which is virtually impossible to get in New York State. So many people, for reasons of conscience and faith, file a religious exemption to vaccinations, and not many. We're a very tiny minority. We're maybe 1% in the whole state. And now our state legislature is threatening to take that right away, not only taking away the right to raise our kids as we see fit, to make our own medical choices for our own family, but also to take away a constitutional freedom that we've had for over 100 years. So it's all created by this fake measles epidemic, which in reality isn't really much of an epidemic at all. If you read the mainstream media, you're led to believe that there's 600 or 200 cases, whatever the figure is today, on any given day. But the reality is that's spread out over about 7 or 8 months. So, for example, Rockland County has... right now, where they have single digits, I'm going to say between 4 to 8 active measles cases in Rockland County as we speak. And if you call the Rockland County Department of Health, they will have to tell you that. So they're looking to take away a freedom. And you're right, it's motivated by Big Pharma. But there's more parents than there are lobbyists. And I always hold to that. And as long as we get in touch with our legislators and talk to them, have reasonable conversations, make it clear that we will not vote for them if they support this bill, and we show up at a rally that we're having. I'm president of the New York Alliance for Vaccine Rights, and we're throwing a big rally in Albany on May 14th, which is a Tuesday, all day from 9 to 5. I would encourage you, Gary, I would invite you to come and speak to many of your adoring fans. I'm sure we'll be there. We would love to have you speak. And anybody listening, please come to Albany on May 14th. We have to stake our flag in the ground and say, no, it's our body, it's our children, it's our family, it's our belief system, and it's our right to go through the research, to soul search, and to make a decision that best fits our belief system and the knowledge that we've gained, because 90% of the legislators, 95% of the legislators, like you say, I talked to, don't know anything. They know nothing. They don't know that the schedule has quadrupled in 20 years. They don't know any facts. They don't know any ingredients that are in the vaccines. They're shocked when they learn that. Sure.
Rita, let me give you a few examples here that will help. Unfortunately, I am just about to start a 2-week retreat, and it'll take me right through that date. However, I'd be happy to talk by conference call if you could arrange the technical aspect of that to the group. I'm happy to do that. The last time I was up there, we led an spontaneous group. We had 24 hours. We got 1,400 people on the steps of the Albany, the Capitol, the next day. And that was primarily from our WBAI audience. And we actually stopped mandatory flu vaccines. There were four vaccines. We stopped it. Then we got hearings. Then those of us who have the knowledge on vaccine safety and efficacy gave testimony, and that stopped it in its tracks. My suggestion now, we have 52 articles showing you the lack of efficacy and safety in vaccines. These are all scholarly. They're all fully scientifically referenced from peer-reviewed literature from PubMed, the government's own official pub site. That should give them pause. Then we have some documentaries, four of them. They're my gift to the movement, and including the latest one, which is the most powerful, called, and by the way, we have Vaccine Nation, and we have Autism Made in USA, and we have The Silent Epidemic, and that's, and those are the ones that you should at least get copies. If you need copies, ask Jay, my art director, and he'll make you copies to give to every legislator. So, and again, I'm willing to pay for that, and Deadly Deception is the one that they should absolutely positively get. Deadly Deception. So if we get them information where their scientists, peer review literature, and board certified pediatricians saying, as a pediatrician, I gave vaccines by the thousands until I looked at the literature. I wasn't willing to believe her, the woman who had a vaccine injured child. And that was my mistake. And now I realize that we were all captivated by propaganda from the vaccine industry, which is Big Pharma. So use the tools we have, because there's nothing more compelling than watching a documentary like Deadly Deception. And again, We'll make all the copies you need. Get them into the hands of every legislator. Get them in the hands of the media. And then let them take issue with that. Because all they have on their side now are nothing but lies. So work with Rita Palma and her group. We want to stop S2994 and A2371. The vaccine industry is behind it. There's no truth in science behind it. And we're willing to challenge it. We can produce some board-certified pediatricians to be there in person to make the case. The website is mykidsmychoice.com. Mykidsmychoice.com. We're out of time. Thank you all for listening. And remember, we're always going to be on the front lines challenging the corruption of the state and the media. Have a nice day, everyone. We'll be right back.